Gracious Father, we do thank you for the time that you've given us this morning to come together to your house to study your word. Father, we thank you for this time of year that we celebrate the birth of our Savior. We thank you that your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, left the glories and the riches of heaven to come to this earth, to be born to the Virgin Mary, and to walk this earth as a Son of Man. Father, with proclaiming his kingdom, and healing the sick, feeding the hungry, raising the dead, all the while making his way to Calvary, where as our greatest high priest, he offered up himself, the perfect Lamb of God, the sinless Lamb of God, the only sacrifice that could satisfy the Father's wrath against sin, and make it possible for those who believe to be forgiven of all their sins covered by the blood of Jesus, just as if they'd never sinned. And Father, we thank you that after Jesus died and was buried 3 days later, he rose again, victorious over sin, Satan, and death. And we know that he's seated now at your right side in the position of power and authority, and there he's interceding for us, waiting for the moment he's going to come back and claim his bride. We thank you, Father, for your gift that you gave us, this gift of redemption, the gift of salvation through your Son, Jesus. We just ask, Father, that your Spirit would guide us this morning and help us to understand your word. We lift up these prayer requests, Father. We pray for Trail that you would strengthen her back and help her with that. We think of Julie's mom and dad and her sister. We just pray that you watch over them and keep them safe and healthy. We pray for Greta Causey and her family that you would bless there and encourage them. And again, Father, we just thank you for this time. We thank you for this church, for the place where we can gather to be with brothers and sisters and worship you and lift you up. And we thank you again for the opportunity to study your word this morning. We ask all these things in your Son's precious and holy name. Amen. This morning we're continuing this series, Lessons that David has written. Thanks be to God for Emmanuel. And what we're going to be looking at primarily this morning is Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. Now, Isaiah, of course, a prophet to Israel, but also, Brother David, also a prophet primarily to Judah, because at this time we have two kingdoms, the northern kingdom of Israel, the 10 tribes, and then we have the southern kingdom of Judah. And although he was prophesying mainly to Judah, he was also prophesying to Israel. His name means the Lord of salvation, very similar to what Jesus means and what Joshua means. He prophesied from 739 to 688 B.C., some 700-something years before the prophecy that we're going to be looking at was fulfilled in the incarnation of Jesus. He prophesied during the reigns of four different kings of Judah, Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah. During this time, the 10 northern tribes, 722 B.C., they were carried into captivity by the Assyrians. So this was during the time that he was preaching to the southern kingdom. The section that we're looking at, the big section, is Isaiah chapter 7 through 12. It's a section that deals with judgment and discipline, but also within that section of judgment, there's hope. God's prophet gives him words of hope to carry them through this. The biggest problem during this time in the nation of Israel was just the fact that the kings were so wicked. David, as he was teaching us last week, was talking about they were living in darkness. It's because they had rejected the light. You know, Yahweh was their light. The Lord was their light, and they just rejected him. And one of the biggest problems was the area of the kings, the leadership. Isaiah chapter 10, verses 1 and 2 tell us, "Woe to those who exact evil statutes, to those who constantly record unjust decisions, so as to deprive the needy of justice and rob the poor of my people of their rights, so that widows may be their spoil and that they may plunder the orphans." You know, just through all of Scripture, that God's heart was for the helpless, for the widows, for the orphans, for those who couldn't care for themselves. And the leaders at this time, and especially the time this prophecy that we're looking at is going to be given, during the time of King Ahaz. Bad king. He wasn't very good at all. And so Isaiah is telling these people, God's going to judge you. God's going to discipline you. And in spite of that, they were still living wicked lives. But even though they were living in darkness, in the midst of all this, these prophecies of judgment, God gave them hope. First, you can look in, or you can just write this down, Isaiah chapter 10, verses 20 through 22. He talks about the remnant. And Kenny talked about that in his sermon last Sunday. There would always be a people, there would always be a remnant that God would look out for, that God would provide for, that God would save. And so there was that hope. And also, one of the key verses for this lesson and the next lesson, Isaiah 7:14, "Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, a virgin will be with child and bear a son. She will call his name Emmanuel." And that's one of the big keys of all these lessons, God with us. And that's what we're going to be talking about this morning. What's in the name, not specifically Emmanuel, but we're going to be looking at Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. And we're going to be looking at most of verse 6. Brother JC is going to take the very last part of verse 6 and verse 7 next Sunday. So if you want to look ahead and be preparing for that, you can look at those verses. But this morning, if you look at Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6, it says, "For a child will be born to us, a son will be given to us, and the government will rest on his shoulders. His name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Eternal Father, Prince of Peace." This morning, for those of you who like outlines, this lesson has been outlined in this way. It's called Unwrapping the Gift of Christ. Number one, a birth and a gift. Number two is Wonderful Counselor. Number three is Mighty God. And finally, number four, so what? And I think I can see David in the outline here, especially when you get to number four, so what? But that's really the best part, because, you know, many times, let's face it, we study and we read and we just study and read. We don't go, well, so what? What does this mean to me? How should it affect my life? We'll take a quick look at that. But anyway, we're going to start. He's got a really good quote here from Charles Spurgeon that I'm going to save for the end. I'm going to put it at the end instead of having it at the start. So if I forget when we get down to the end, and I'm prone to do that, I'm not a young man. So if I get toward the end and say, okay, well, you know, let's just meditate. Wait a minute. You said there was a quote. So remind me, please. Anyhow, first part of the outline, a birth and a gift. What we're looking at, of course, is certainly a child will be born, a son will be given to us, and we know, of course, this is Jesus Christ. And again, some 700-something years earlier, this has been prophesied by Isaiah that the Messiah would come, the one who would deliver his people, and we know that this one who's coming is a king. He's going to deliver, he's going to come as a king, he's going to come as man. Other prophecies refer to him as the Son of Man. Jesus himself, many times, that was the phrase he used the most, referred to himself, was the Son of Man. So it denotes his humanity. Prophecy of Isaiah chapter 7 tells us it'll be a special birth. He's going to be born of a virgin. That's unheard of, isn't it? And many people couldn't accept that, can't accept that, that the Son of God would come to be born of a virgin. But he was born as a baby. You know, we celebrate this time of year, that little baby in the manger. I've got a nativity out in front of my house. And by the way, if you like Christmas lights, please come by 241 Church Street. The log house over there down from the fire department, you'll see some Christmas lights. But I have that little baby Jesus in the manger. Because that's the gift that was given to us, was God himself coming to us as a baby, as a human. And so these prophecies, also when we think about Emmanuel, God with us, we think of a ruler. As you look in Isaiah, there's several other verses in this series, this section, chapter 7 through 12, that talks about, matter of fact, the verse we just read, that the government will rest on his shoulders. Very next verse, on the throne of David and over his kingdom is where he's going to reign. So this is a king coming, but one of the things that's noted in our lesson is that all the references to the fact that this will be a king, he's never called a king. And Gerhard von Rad believes that this is a slap to the kings of that time, especially Ahaz, who was the current king of Judah. I mean, the wicked guy. And so this is a slap saying, this one that's coming, he has all the qualifications. He's more than qualified to be the king and to take care of his people and rule his people. But guess what? He doesn't need a title. You guys have got the title, and you're not kings. You're worthless. You're the worst leaders that Israel's ever had. That's one of the main themes of this, is what terrible leadership the people are having at this time. Isaiah 9:2, the people who walk in darkness will see a great light. Those who live in a dark land, the light will shine on them. And as David was talking about this last week, you know, this idea of living in darkness, again, it's just ignorance. It's rejecting the light, rejecting their God, because God had made it clear. God had let them know through his law and through his prophets and through all time, this is what I expect of my people. This is what I want from my people, how I want you to live. They just refused it, especially at this time and within the leadership. And so he's sending this king, but let's face it, he's more than a king. This Messiah is going to rule as a man coming as a baby. But then we have this next description, a son will be given. The second description refers to the fact that he's divine ruler. He's the Son of God. You know, that there's a lot here that's is sort of hard if you think about it and really dwell on it. He's the eternal God, so he has no beginning, but yet he's born as a baby. And, you know, sometimes when we're witnessing to people and talking to people, we should understand a lot of this that we believe, it's hard. And a lot of it is we just accept by faith. But as we look at this, if you look in John chapter 1, verses 1 through 5, a very familiar passage. In the beginning was the Word, referring to Jesus. The Word was with God. The Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came to being through him. He was there at creation. Apart from him, nothing came into being and has come to being. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. There's that light. It's missing in the prophecies of Isaiah. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. Drop down to verse 14, another familiar verse. The Word became flesh, the incarnation, the baby in the manger, and dwelt among us, and we saw his glory, glory as of the only begotten from the Father, full of grace and truth. John 3:16, very familiar verse, tells us that God sent his only begotten Son. This idea of only begotten, he is the only one. He's the unique one. There's no one else like Jesus. He's unique in his class. There's no other person who shares his relationship, his exact relationship with the Father. Jesus is the only begotten Son. We are adopted children. You know, he's our brother, but we're not like Jesus. We can't compare to Jesus. He is the one and only, the unique, only begotten Son of God. Also, it's clear through these verses and through all Scripture, the idea of the Trinity. And again, that's another one. That's a tough concept. I've heard it explained so many ways, and every way I've heard it explained comes up short. This idea that Jesus and the Father are one. The statement, systematic theology by Wayne Grudem, the summary, the statement of the biblical teaching of the Trinity. Number one, God is three persons. Number two, each person is fully God. And number three, there is one God. So, three persons, but they're all God. That's the idea of the Trinity. And again, to me, and I think most people, that's a tough one. I've got a really good quote, another quote from Spurgeon. I'm going to go ahead and read this one so I don't forget it. Talking about attempting to grasp the infinite. The doctrine of the eternal affiliation of Christ, the Trinity, is to be received as an undoubted truth of our holy religion. But as to any explanation of it, no man should venture thereon. For it remaineth among the deep things of God, one of those solemn mysteries indeed, into which the angels dare not look, nor do they desire to pry into it, a mystery which we must not attempt to fathom, for it is utterly beyond the grasp of any finite being. I like this next sentence. As well might a gnat seek to drink in the ocean as a finite creature to comprehend the eternal God. I think that's pretty good. As well as a gnat might seek to drink in the ocean, is for us as finite beings to try to figure out all these things about God. It's not to mean we're not supposed to study and attempt and do our best, but to understand the Trinity is a tough one. He goes on, a God whom we could understand would be no God. If we could grasp him, he could not be infinite. If we could understand him, then were he not divine? We do know that Christ became a man. He was born of a virgin. He was sent by the Father to fulfill the promise of redemption, that there would be one coming who would save his people. Now, we certainly know that there were many ideas of what this redemption was going to be. Certainly the people of Israel, especially the ones who were in captivity, they were looking for freedom. They were looking for a Messiah that would come and ride in and take care of those who were oppressing them and give them back their freedom. Well, we know that there's a Messiah like that coming. It is going to defeat evil. It is going to bring everyone freedom. But the one that was coming at the time that we're looking was not that type of Messiah. And that's another reason the people of Jesus' day had a hard time. You know, they were oppressed. They were people who were under subjugation to the Romans, and they were looking for relief. They were looking for physical relief. And Jesus came to bring them spiritual relief. And they had a tough time with that. But anyway, we also know that this Lord, this King, this Messiah will be sovereign. He has all power. He's over all things. He is God. He created all things. So who's over all things? The person who created all things. That's pretty simple, isn't it? Although man likes to deny that, we think we have something to do with what's going on. We don't. It's all in God's hands, and for those of us who know God, that makes us so happy. It brings us such peace, such hope, such joy that we're not in control. I'm going to tell you the truth. I've done so many things and started so many projects that after I got into them, I was like, wow, I'm just making a big old mess. And, you know, I'm grateful that my life is not in my hands, because if it was, it'd be a mess. It's in God's hands, and God knows everything and knows what he's doing. Brings me great joy and great peace that he is reigning, that the government's on his shoulders. It's not on the Republican shoulders. It's not on the Democrat shoulders. It's not only the man's shoulders. And that's another thing that should bring us great peace. Our country's in turmoil. We've been in turmoil for I don't know how long, especially when it comes to our leadership at the highest level. That's a shame that we just are getting further and further apart from each other. And, you know, people are driving other people away instead of welcoming people in. But we know that our God, that the government's on his shoulders, that he's in control. You know, that simple model prayer, and sometimes called the Lord's Prayer, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth. That's what we ought to be praying. And it is being done. We need to rest in that, that God is accomplishing his perfect purpose. Also, this part of this verse says unto us, that this child is for us. Made me think of the shepherds. You know, when they're out there and it's peaceful, and all of a sudden the sky lights up, and they're terrified because they don't know what's happening. And the angel has come to announce the birth of Jesus. And he tells them in Luke chapter 2, today in the city of David there has been born for you a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. The Messiah has been born for you, for us, just like Isaiah's telling us here these many hundred years earlier. This Savior, the good news is he's come for each of us, for those he's going to save. Jesus is the gospel. You know, sometimes we make the mistake. I know when I was growing up, back in the 60s and the 70s, you know, one of the big thrusts when you went to church, the main message was, you want to miss hell and make heaven. End of every service, there was an invitation, because nobody wants to go to hell, which nobody should want to go to hell. But you want to go to heaven. And that was always the big push, every service, was to make sure that that invitation was given, that people had the opportunity to not make that mistake. But, let's face it, the gospel is so much more than missing hell and making it to heaven. It's a whole lot more than that. As David has written in this lesson, Jesus Christ is the gospel. A personal relationship with Jesus, to know him, to be known by him. You know, when the Bible talks about God knowing us, Jesus knowing us, it's the word that means intimate knowledge. I know things about a lot of stuff. I don't know a lot about some of those things. The knowledge that God has of us, that Jesus has of us, is deep, it's intimate, He wants that relationship with us. And so that's the gospel. It's all about God. It's not about us. When I started teaching Sunday school, which has been a while ago, back in the early 80s when we first came to this church, I had one of those moments that you sort of dread, and they just had the pastor call me into the office. He said, at that time I was in the young marrieds class, I'd never taught adults. He said, one of our older adult classes, teachers left, and basically what it was, they had all they wanted, and they left. He said, I want you to teach that class. I was like, are you talking to me? Jan, my wife, and I had taught children's classes. I'd never taught an adult class, and this was an older adult class that, for whatever reason, had managed to discourage their teacher so much, he'd left. He'd had enough. But a good thing for you to remember is that when a leader, a person you consider spiritual, comes to you and says, hey, I think you need to be doing this and that, and God's put you on my heart that you can do this, go ahead, step out. It seems like that's where I was supposed to be, and the class came back together. Everything was great. At least I thought it was. I hope it was. But anyhow, one of the things when I first started teaching that I always would try to remind my class pretty much every Sunday, it's not about you. It's all about God. And that's the thing that we need to remember. It is all about God. We are so blessed. I'm grateful for God's plans and for God's will. It's not that he's doing these things because of me. I just end up receiving the blessings because I'm in God's will and what God's doing. One of the biggest mistakes that the nation of Israel made was they became very presumptuous. That's the reason God sent men like Isaiah and these other prophets. They felt like we're God's people, and so God has to take care of us. They felt like they were special, that it was all about them. And God was obligated to take care of them, to meet their needs, and do whatever for them. And that's the reason they were so presumptuous. We can live how we want because we're God's special people. What they forgot was all the many times that men like Moses told them back in Deuteronomy and other places, there's nothing special about you. God didn't choose you because you were special. If anything, the way you can look at it is they were special because God chose them. God chose them because his purpose and his plan was he wanted to remove the pagans who were living in the promised land. He had given them opportunity after opportunity to worship him, to repent, and to follow him. They wouldn't do it. So his judgment on those nations was to destroy them. Israel was his instrument. He was going to use them to accomplish his will. He didn't pick them because of all the countries that were there and all the people that were there. Oh, look at this group. This is a really good group. Again, Moses told him so many times, you are stiff-necked. You're all the time rebelling. You know, even God at times, when he's bringing them out of Egypt to the promised land, remember, he would tell Moses, I'll just destroy them all and start with a new group with you. Of course, Moses being the man of God that he was, he would intervene and intercede. But anyhow, the point being, we don't need to be presumptuous. God is God. God is so much above us. And yet, he sent his son unto us, this baby born in the manger. Next part of the outline is the wonderful counselor. This idea of being a wonderful counselor, the idea of wonder, if you look, some of you, if you happen to have a King James or American Standard, you've got a comma in between the wonderful and counselor. Doesn't really matter, because both of those words refer to this child that's being born. Matter of fact, most theologians believe that the statement as it's written in Scripture, Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace, this certainly refers to the child that he has just referred to in the previous verse. But there are some theologians who think this is a statement about God. And they word it this way. Wonderful in counsel is the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. both statements certainly hold a lot of truth, so I'm not going to get too excited about either one of them, or don't say it that way. I'm not going to get mad or upset or reject either one of them. Both statements are true. But for what we're looking at, I think the way it's written, wonderful counselor, mighty God, everlasting Father, Prince of Peace, is referring to this baby, this child that's been born. And again, this idea, he is wonderful. He is incomprehensible. This word is used, always used, refer to God, except one time in Lamentations 1:9, where it referred to Jerusalem, but normally it refers to God. It's used to describe the miraculous, the supernatural. Remember in the Gospel of John, John had the signs for a purpose, to help people see that these miracles, these signs, pointed to God. The fact that Jesus Christ was God, that no one could do these things, no one could accomplish these miracles, except God himself. And so this baby, this one who's coming, he's going to be wonderful. He's going to be a wonder. You think about how Jesus causes people to be full of wonder. And again, we have to be careful, because when we use the word wonderful, we don't put quite as much weight on it. You know, we can eat a really good meal someplace. Well, that's wonderful. Or we can go to a performance. Maybe the person singing is just has a great voice. Wonderful. And then we use the same word to talk about Jesus. So needless to say, the way we use wonderful and the wonderfulness of Jesus, it's two different things. It's much heavier. It's much weightier. He's wonderful in a mind-boggling sense. Let's put it that way. Think about when he was on this earth, how he demonstrated his wonderfulness. Number one, what we're talking about right now, the incarnation. The eternal God, the creator, the one who's always been, all of a sudden comes to this earth as this baby in a manger. What can babies do for themselves? I've had two children, and I've got three grandchildren. I've got one that's 40-something years old, and she still can't do anything for herself. But babies are helpless and hopeless. This little baby depended on Mary completely for all of its needs, just like any baby. Can you imagine? I always loved that song, Mary, did you know? To think about what she's thinking about. She's been told, this is the Son of God. And to be holding that little baby and changing its dirty diaper and feeding that baby. But that's the wonder of the incarnation, that the eternal God could come to be a man and to be the one who would give his life for us. Think about his power to heal. I was thinking this morning, I would like to know how many people Jesus healed. Because in the scripture it just says he goes into a region, to a town, and they bring all the sick to him, and he heals them. It doesn't say he healed some of them. It says he healed them, heals them, all of them. They bring those who are demon-possessed. And what's he do? He casts out all the demons. Now, doesn't that sort of boggle your mind and make you wonder what a wonderful person this man is? How about his teachings? It tells us in the scriptures that the people were amazed. They've never seen anyone, heard anyone who could teach like this, who had the authority like Jesus had. At the same time, there were many who were offended. His teaching was so above them, especially in his hometown. You remember he went to his hometown, he taught, and what happened? They were offended. Isn't this the carpenter's son? Don't we know his family? Who do you think he is? He was saying such great things that it was so over them, they were offended. That's just the carpenter's boy. And what'd they do? They wanted to take him out the cliff and throw him off and kill him. But he walked through them. Anyhow, people were amazed, or whether it was amazed for joy or amazed for hatred, they were amazed at his teachings. How about his perfect life? He was a wonder. He was wonderful. And finally, let's face it, the climax, the peak of all this, the resurrection. How does the Son of God die on the cross and come back to life? It goes up there with the Trinity, one of those things that we are so blessed to be a part of, so blessed to know, maybe not completely understand, but yet by faith we accept the fact that Jesus Christ gave his life on that cross and didn't just die. You know, there are a lot of martyrs, there are a lot of famous people, prominent people who died but they didn't come back to life. That sets Jesus apart, and of course the reason he's set apart is because he is the Son of God. This divine deliverer is both man, both God, possesses absolute wisdom. He's not just sort of smart, he's not a little bit wise. He possesses absolute wisdom. That's the reason the religious leaders, all the time, they're trying to trap him. And what would happen? Jesus would give them an answer or not give them an answer. They just had to walk off because he was so much wiser than they were. And his wisdom was beyond human wisdom. The next part of this title, Wonderful Counselor, the idea of counselor. A counselor is one who gives advice. If you look in Isaiah 10, verses 1 and 2, it tells us, a shoot will spring forth from the stem of Jesse, and a branch from his roots will bear fruit. The Spirit of the Lord will rest on him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and strength, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. And of course, Isaiah is talking about this coming Messiah. Jesus Christ had all these qualities. He had all wisdom. He didn't need human counsel. Again, when he would teach, the people were amazed. It was like one who he taught with authority. He wasn't repeating what the rabbis had taught the other rabbis that taught the other rabbis. He was teaching things that they'd never heard before and teaching with authority. And so he didn't need folks surrounding him, but he can give counsel. We think a counselor and this idea of wisdom, because the reason he can be a counselor is he possesses all wisdom. He's wise. You think about Solomon over in 1 Kings 4, the wise king that Solomon was. You think about the Lord himself, Isaiah 28, 29. This also comes from the Lord of hosts. He is wonderful in counsel and excellent in wisdom. In Colossians 2, 3, it tells us that Christ is a wise counselor. In him is hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. Christ's position as our wonderful counselor means we can trust him to listen to our problems and guide us in the right direction. Proverbs 3, 6. If you need advice, if you need help, go to the Lord in prayer. Because what you get from him, you can go to the bank. We can be sure he is listening because he told us to pray to him about our worries. Philippians 4, 6 and James 1, 5. We can be certain he has our best interests at heart because he loves us. 1 John 4, 19. His love is so wide and deep and wonderful that we cannot fully understand it. Romans 5, 8. This is a counselor that we can count on. We know how much he loves us. He demonstrated that on the cross. He gave everything for you. He gave everything for me. He will give us counsel that is based on complete understanding, complete wisdom. He knows everything. One of the words that Dave was talking last week about for the children, the omni words, this word omniscient. He knows everything. He knows all things. Psalms 139, verses 1 through 6. O Lord, you've searched me and known me. You know when I sit down, when I rise up, you understand my thoughts from afar. You scrutinize my path, my lying down, and are intimately acquainted with all my ways. Even before there is a word on my tongue, behold, O Lord, you know it all. You've enclosed me behind and before and laid your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is too high. I cannot attain it. The beauty of our counselor is that he has perfect knowledge. He knows everything about us. And so we don't have to worry. Should I listen to him? It's a no-brainer. Yes, you should listen to Jesus Christ. You should listen to what he says. You should listen to what his spirit speaks to your heart. You should listen to what he says to you in his word. He got it all written down and saved it for you for a reason. It's so you can look in his word and see what he wants you to do and the promises he's made to you to help you live this life. He is the perfect counselor. There's also this idea of Christ as counselor of God. Now, I have to admit, I really hadn't thought about this until I read this lesson. Hadn't thought about it a lot. You know, there are times in the Scripture we can see where the Godhead holds counsel. If you go back to Genesis 1:26, then God said, let us, we certainly know that refers to the Trinity, let us make man in our image according to our likeness. And then it goes on to say, we'll let man rule over creation. So there was a council. God the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. They considered what should be done. You know, there was a plan. That's one of the things, again, I don't know about you, but sometimes I think I have a plan. And then when I get into it, not a great plan. Wasn't even a good plan. But we can rest assured that every time that God does something, every time the Son does something, there's a plan behind it. It's just not, let's do this. No, there's a plan. And it's determined by the council, just like creation was determined. There's also the idea of the eternal council determining the work of providence. You think about this when Adam was judged. You think that was just a flip thing? Well, I'll just kick you out of the garden. That's the best I can do. No. This was planned. There was the council that said, this is going to be what's happened to Adam. How are we going to get Noah out of all this stuff? I mean, who would have thought of this humongous boat, putting all these animals on it, and it floating around out there for all those days? It could only come from God. And one of the big ones is using the sins of Joseph's brothers to save the line of Christ. That's just an amazing story, isn't it? Talk about hard times. Joseph had them. Everything that happened to him there for a while looked bad because it was supposed to be bad. His brothers didn't mean him good. His brothers meant him bad. They wanted to harm him. You remember, they wanted to kill him. Fortunately, one of the brothers, the older brothers, was smart enough to say, no, let's just sell him slavery. And all the things that happened after that, we don't have time to cover that. You know the story. But when his brothers finally came before Joseph and Joseph revealed himself, what did he tell them? You meant this for bad. God meant it for good. God was going to use Joseph's position now to save his people. And who was going to come from the people of Israel, from the Jews? The Messiah. So he saves the line of Christ. All these things, the plan of redemption from Genesis to Revelation, it's all been determined in the council. You know, sometimes I think we think the Old Testament, you know, well, the plan was the law. Well, that didn't work out, so God had to come up with another plan. No. Redemption through Jesus Christ was the plan from the beginning. From before creation, God knew that Jesus would be offered. Basically, what he did in the Old Testament proved us our inability to live and please God and to live good enough to be saved, to save ourselves. And again, these councils of God, you have the council of the eternal council deciding the matter of grace, sovereign grace. These things cannot be something that just happened. These things that were planned out and came to being because God intended them. It's God's will. It's God's plan. And certainly God the Son and God the Spirit are part of this. Before the creation, our names were written in the book of life. Those who are going to be saved, you know, I guess when I was younger, I sort of thought, as people were saved, there's another name written in the book of life. I didn't know. And then as I matured, understood, no, those names are already there. God's not writing the book of life. The book of life has been written. And God knew because it was his plan. So everything has been planned. And again, I don't know about you, gives me great peace. We're living in a country that doesn't know who's going to be in charge in January. We don't know what's going to happen, but I know who's in charge. It's our sovereign Lord. He's got a plan, and he's going to work his plan. So let that bring you peace. There's also this idea of Christ as the angel of the councils. And if you look in Exodus, you remember the burning bush? Many times in the scripture it refers to the angel of the Lord. Well, that angel of the Lord is Jesus. And you can just tell this is not one of the regular angels. This is an angel that people worship, an angel that people bow before. And so this is Jesus. In one of the cases, Exodus 3, the burning bush, that was certainly the angel of the Lord speaking to Moses and letting him know, I am who I am, Yahweh, the great I am. And again, we get to the New Testament. God revealed that he was, or Jesus revealed he was the messenger of God's plan. He came to this earth as a baby. He walked this earth proclaiming the message of God. He died on the cross for our sins and rose again. He certainly proclaimed the message of God. Well, that gets us to the third part of the outline, and I'm running out of time, but we still got about 15 minutes. I'll try not to keep you late. So those of you who are in my Sunday school class go, yeah. Fat chance. Huh? Anyhow, mighty God. Now certainly you hear the name mighty. That refers to strength and power. You remember in the Old Testament there were mighty men? David had a list of the mighty men of valor. These were his greatest warriors, the warriors he put in charge of other warriors, because they were so mighty. You remember when Israel decided against God's will to pick a king? God tried to tell him, Samuel tried to tell him, big mistake. You're going to regret it. But they wanted a king. And who did they pick? The guy that stood head and shoulders above everybody else, the strong man, Saul. And that didn't turn out great. He was replaced by David, who was also known for his victories. He was a great warrior. Saul did not have a lot of spiritual sense. David was blessed with spiritual sense, but he wasn't real smart. He had his moments. He made some very bad decisions. But the promised king that is coming, he's mighty. He's the Almighty. And he's not going to make those mistakes. His reign is going to be a reign of power. He's going to overthrow anyone that's in his way, and he's going to rule with perfect wisdom and judgment. The second part of this, God, this child again, we've already covered this, that's going to be born to us, is God himself, the Trinity. When that baby was lying in that manger, that was God lying in that manger. When Jesus was walking on the water, that was God walking on the water. When he was murdered on that cross, that was God on that cross. And when he was raised again, when he came back to life, that was God. So this God that Isaiah is prophesying about, this Messiah, is God. The word El is used here. Most religions of that time used that word. The Canaanite religion, El was the greatest of all gods. Well, certainly for the Jewish people, he was the only God who was over all. Whether it's other gods, you know, that's sort of taught in the Old Testament. We don't believe in the other gods, but the people of that time did. And God let them know, I'm over everything. If there are other gods, I'm over them. I'm over all of creation. So this prophecy about the Messiah is about God himself. He's coming. He's donning flesh. He's going to dwell among us. And he's come to deliver us. Isaiah tells us he's all-knowing, wise, and mighty God. And because of that, again, I've been talking about this. If he knows everything about you, if he has complete understanding, complete wisdom, and he loves you with a love that we can't fathom, and he means only the best for you, do you need to worry about what he wants you to do and his decisions for you? Do you need to worry? You know, many people among us are concerned, and some very concerned about all that's going on right now with the pandemic and with politics and all these different things. I mean, the world has been in turmoil for a long time. It's in greater turmoil at the moment, and many are concerned. But as God's people, we should certainly be praying about these things. I hope you pray for your president, for the government every day. I prayed for every president since I've been able to pray. Didn't like all of them, but I prayed for them because I look in the Old Testament and even in the New Testament, and I see where God used kings and rulers who were just wicked, but God used them. And so pray for your leadership. Pray about these problems. I'm praying about these vaccines, that God will give all of our folks in research the ability to come up with a good vaccine and things that will help. And anyway, we shouldn't despair because we know God's in control. And we know he's good, and we know that it's all going to work out for the good of his people and for his glory. So we can rest in that. Is God worthy of our heeding? Oh, I'm sorry. I'm to the so what part. For those of you who are doing an outline, I'm on number four. I'm to the so what. Does he really know best? Is he all-knowing? Does he have perfect wisdom and understanding? And we've answered that. Yes, he does. So we can rest in that because everything he's doing is for our good. The idea in the Bible of a wise counselor is one that has wise words. We believe that the words of the Scripture are wise. They contain all wisdom. And so why would we not heed these words? You know, as God's people, one of the things for certain that we ought to be doing every day is reading the Word of God. That's how he speaks to us. We speak to him in prayer. He speaks to us through his word, through his spirit. And so we should be in the regular habit. And I know most of you are, probably all of you are, and that's good. But let's face it, we have brothers and sisters that sometimes that Bible has to get dusted off before they use it. And we need to be concerned about it. We need to be encouraging each other. We should be people of the word. If we believe these things about our Messiah, that he is truly God, that he has all wisdom, all understanding, all power, we ought to be reading what he has to say, shouldn't we? And that's good advice for us. And finally, do we realize the connection of God's grace and power? Certainly, everything about our life is by grace. Everything he's done for us is by his grace. Again, thinking back on the nation of Israel, did God owe them anything? No. Does God owe us anything? No. But by his grace, he has decided to bless us. He's decided on this plan of redemption through this little baby born in the manger. He's made it possible for us to be redeemed, to be a part of the family of God, to know him. And here's the part I think I'm really lax on. He wants us to know him intimately. I don't think I'm there. I know he knows me intimately. Sometimes that's a little scary. But he wants us to know him intimately. Well, how are we going to do that? What we're doing right now. Worship services, studying this word, all these different things that we can do to know him in a very close and very personal way. So that's the so what. What does it mean to us that God sent this little baby that Isaiah prophesied about some 800 years earlier, that God sends this little baby, it's the eternal God, but yet he has a beginning in a manger as a baby. You know, okay. And he is God, along with the Father and the Spirit. He has all knowledge, all wisdom, all understanding. He loves us perfectly. I mean, you put all this stuff together, what does it mean? We are so blessed. And like David, we don't rejoice in Christmas just at Christmas time. We rejoice in the birth of our Savior all year long. And we rejoice in his resurrection from the dead. Let me go back to the start of this. I want to give you this quote from Charles Spurgeon. Celebrating Christmas, we see, therefore, that the Virgin Mary called her son Emmanuel, that there might be a meaning in his name, God with us. My soul, ring these words again, God with us. Oh, it's one of the bells of heaven. Let us strike it yet again, God with us. Oh, it is a stray note from the Sonnets of Paradise, God with us. Oh, it is the lisping of a seraph, God with us. Oh, it is one of the notes of the singing of Jehovah when he rejoices over his church with singing, God with us. Tell it, tell it, tell it. This is the name of him who is born today. Mr. Charles Spurgeon. Any questions or comments? I meant to do what David did last week and say anytime, you know, just talk or raise your hand. I'm sorry. I got cranked up and just took off. Anybody have anything? Well, thank you so much for coming this morning. Again, the third lesson in this series will be next Sunday. Brother J.C. will be leading that lesson. It finishes verse 6 and goes on to verse 7. So be praying for Brother J.C. as he prepares, and you can prepare too as you read those scriptures this week. Let's have a prayer and we'll dismiss. Gracious Father, we do thank you again for every opportunity you give us together in your house. We thank you for the blessedness of being a part of your family. We thank you that you did send Jesus to this earth, and Jesus in his obedience came and was born of the Mary and made his way to the cross and gave himself for us, and he rose again victorious over sin, Satan, death, and the grave. And we are so grateful for all the blessings that are ours, not because of us, but because of your grace and because of your mercy. And I just again ask your blessing on each one who's here today. Be with us as we go into the worship service, and we pray for our pastor as he stands to preach this morning, that you would guide him, let your spirit speak through him and touch each heart. We pray especially, Father, if there's anyone with us this morning who is yet to acknowledge you, yet to acknowledge this Savior, this Christ, and receive him as personal Savior, that even now your Spirit is guiding them, convicting them, and drawing them to your Son. And we ask this might be their day of salvation. And we ask all these things in your Son's precious and holy name. Amen.